Welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations, Religion and Foreign Policy webinar series. This series convenes religion and faith-based leaders in cross-denominational dialogue on the intersection between religion and international relations. I'm Irina Fascianis, Vice President of the National Program and Outreach here at CFR. The webinar is on the record and the audio, video, and transcript will be made available on CFR's website, cfr.org, and on our iTunes podcast channel, Religion and Foreign Policy. As always, CFR takes no institutional positions on matters of policy. We're delighted to have Ray Takeyh with us to moderate today's discussion on the protests in Iran. Ray Takeyh is the Hasib J. Sabbagh Senior Fellow for Middle East Studies at CFR. His areas of specialization are Iran, U.S. foreign policy, and the modern Middle East. He served as a senior advisor on Iran at the U.S. State Department, a fellow at Yale University, and has had other positions. He's the author or co-author of 6 books. Most recently, his last one was The Last Shah, America, Iran, and the Fall of the Pahlavi Dynasty. So Ray, thank you very much for doing this. I'm going to turn it over to you to introduce our speakers and to moderate the conversation.
Yes, thank you very much, everybody, for joining. Today, we have 2 terrific speakers. Fatemeh Haghighatjoo, besides having a very timely last name, was a former parliamentarian in Iran of the reformist variety. And today, she's a CEO of a Nonviolent Initiative for Democracy. And Professor Tabaar is a professor at Texas A&M Bush School, and his specializations are international security and Middle East politics. He's the author of many timely and important books. I want to dwell right into this discussion, and I want to begin with the parliamentarian Haghighatjoo. And in 42 years since its inception, the Islamic Republic has faced many different kind of protests from many different kind of factions. And the question that usually comes up is why the current protest that began in September with the death of Ms. Amini different, or are they different in any way? Please.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me, and thank you, Ray, for introducing me. I believe this movement is different from the previous movement for several reasons. First of all, as many may know, Iran's constitution is a discriminatory constitution. It discriminates against its variety group, including women, ethnic group, religious group. So women have faced difficulty for past 40 years. And I think in recent event, before September 2022, the morality police violated women, brutally cracked down on them on enforcing the hijab law. And I think women reached to the point after the death of Mahsa Amini in the custody of the morality police that enough is enough. One important aspect has been women's issue. Women have been face of the movement. And also, majority of people in the country are dissatisfied with how the regime runs their everyday life has been deteriorated. And I think everyone, to some extent, felt the anger. And different group came together. There is very limited space on social, economic, political area in the country. So youth also joined to women, and the movement have created. I think another point is that the current movement basically, in general, I believe calls for the fundamental change, which we can read it as a call for a regime change, even though different people join to the movement for different reasons. And some may want improvement of their life, but I think a great number of people really want fundamental change.
Thank you. Professor Tabaar, do you see this movement the same way? And do you believe that it can be durable? What is your perspective on the nature and the resilience of the movement?
Okay, thank you. First of all, thank you, Reena and Ray, for the invitation and for the introduction. It's great to be here on this panel with Fatemeh. I agree with Fatemeh that this is a very radical and widespread movement. It's multi-class. It has affected different segments of the society, different strata in the society, different parts of the country. We see being involved in this movement. Also, she's absolutely right that this is probably one of the most radical movements that the Islamic Republic has been facing since 1979. There is no call for reform, for gradual change. If anything, the protesters are calling for a completely different political system. So in that sense, it's quite different. Another element that is very different in this movement, which is kind of related to, I guess, section of the CFR, religion and foreign policy, is that the role of religion in this movement. There doesn't seem to be any role for religion in this movement, which is quite astonishing for a country in which religion always played a major role. This time around, we don't see any reference to religion or very few in the slogans, in the protesters' platform, not much. We don't see clerics to be an influential part of this movement. So that's another element. In fact, many social scientists in Iran have been writing commentaries and organizing events discussing this phenomenon, that why is it that suddenly the society has become so secular? And in some ways, some of them even argue that this could be potentially a far more significant development than even the 79 revolution. So in that sense, this is quite remarkable what we see. To what extent this is temporary or not, this role of religion, we have to see. But in that sense, it is different. But the question that is this going to lead to any major change? In the short term, if by change we mean political change, a change in the regime, probably not. We have already witnessed that the street protests have kind of declined the past couple of weeks. So in that sense, maybe not. But this is a long-term challenge. This is a long-term challenge between the state and the society, and even the strategists of the regime understand, and they're quite outspoken, that this is going to be a long-term issue that they have to deal with. What they're going to do to amend or to reduce this tension with the society, we'll have to see. But as I said, this is long-term. But let me just say one final point, and that is the challenge that the protesters have faced is that they were not, or they haven't been able to bring the silent majority out. This hasn't happened. This is a majority that sympathizes with the protesters, but for a variety of reasons has decided not to come out yet. That's why we haven't seen the political changes that many people were expecting.
It is often suggested when you're looking at this movement, and I start with you, Ms. Haghighatjoo, it is suggested that it lacks organization, it lacks structure, and it lacks leadership. I want to ask you two questions. I think that's true. Is that necessary for the movement at this stage? And second of all, does it need to have that at some point? And how will it have that in an internally repressive society?
Yes, I think the main shortcoming of the movement is lack of leadership. Like clear, united leadership doesn't mean that at the field level there is no leadership. There are several reasons for that. The one main issue is the regime cracked down heavily. It's over 30,000 people got arrested. Many of them are those who have a potential leadership. So if I look at to any prison in Iran, we could see those who have leaders. So basically one scenario can be seen as leaders are forming from within a prison. Just to name a few, I can say Dengiz Mohammadi can be one of those, really has a great potential, vision, aspiration to be leader. In outside of the country, as we've seen, and it's unique for past 17 years, diaspora has been played in an important role in supporting the movement. As again, we know 80,000 people attended the Berlin rally, over 50,000 people rallied in Toronto in October, but basically, still, we don't see a unified leadership because of different issue. One is a historical fear, which goes back to 1979 leadership that Khomeini and its ally that has a long-lasting network throughout the country could take over and purge the rest, ideological differences, personality differences, and sometimes lack of a great leadership. And also the Iranian security forces manipulation. Combination of these several factors do not allow the opposition outside of Iran come together and get united. Even if there have been some efforts, I don't see it. So for now, because the regime for past two decades have invested on security forces, military to crack down on political parties, organizations, civil society, journalists, press. So they have been trying to monitor everything and bring them to question them, make them silent. So I think because of the level of repression, as you mentioned, it is difficult to form a leadership core inside the country. So there are dots. People are working around the country, but they were not able to connect together because of that. So for now, maybe that is okay. Also, I don't see it is necessary that in a daily or weekly basis, people come to the street, different way of non-cooperative behaviors, actions can also help the movement to grow in next couple of years. But I think if we want to see this movement to continue, it has to have a leadership. And I think it is important those who are in diaspora get together, form leadership. But I feel the main leadership has to come from within Iran. I don't want to separate between Iran, inside Iran, outside Iran. This is a way that the security forces in Iran like to do. But connection with inside Iran is very important because they know daily things. Outside, they can create a strategy, but it's a shared strategy that people inside Iran can understand as well. So I believe at some point in near future, really, we need to have a leadership for the movement to succeed.
Thank you. Professor Tabaar, I want to ask you about the performance of the regime for the past 3 months, because there is a record of its performance. And, you know, it seems to me that the regime has in some way has lost its footing, has lost its narrative. It's for the hijab, it's for loose hijab, it's for restriction of hijab. Different people are saying different things. The prosecutor is saying one thing, the head of judiciary another thing. If you can assess the performance of the regime, particularly focus on the security services, because at this point, the Islamic Republic has only security services as a means of its prolongation and power. But this is also, in many ways, a conscript force. How do you assess the performance of the regime and the reliability of the security services as it continues to face domestic dissent?
First of all, you're absolutely right. They have lost the narrative, and they know this. And that's why they're trying to come up with a long-term solution to fix this problem. And that is, instead of relying on religion, they're using other forms of narratives, national security, nationalism, patriotism, and other things. And they keep saying that this is not about veiling, this is not about hijab. And by losing narrative, it's not just within the opposition. Losing narrative, as you said, among even their own supporters. Right. But the security forces, there have been some signs of tensions within the security forces, but overall, we do not see any crack within the security forces, and that which is the key for any revolutionary movement to succeed. We don't see that. And they're not conscript. They are actually well-paid members of the regime. So far, yes, there are some reports that security elements have been tired and they have been criticized even by their own family members. But so far, they have managed to put down, crack down on protesters. But again, this may not be a long-term issue. But here is what the regime is doing to reduce the tensions and the reliance on security forces in the short term. And that's exactly what you were saying about how they are framing this the tensions about veiling and hijab. That's why we're seeing different signals from the regime, because they want to reduce the state society confrontation. They don't want to have the morality police in the streets having tensions, physical conflicts with the citizens that sparked the very movement a few months ago. They want to reduce this. So, in order to do that, they're trying to redefine the veiling issue. And a few weeks ago, you were right. I think it was the Justice Department, I believe, announced something, a vague statement that basically they put an end to the morality police. It was not clear exactly what they meant. And I think it was ambiguous by design. And then a few days ago, the Supreme Leader Ayatollah Khamenei said that that compulsory veiling is very much part of the core part of Islamic law, and the state has to enforce it. And yet he actually lowered the bar by saying that those who are not properly veiled, partially veiled, or he used the word, he said, hijab is zaif, and they have their veiled weakly or whatever, however you can translate this, they should not be seen as subversive or anti-regime elements, which is interesting, because up until recently, the morality police was were after anyone who was not potentially after anyone who was not following the strict dress code. But now Khamenei is reducing that and saying, basically signaling that only those who are defiantly unveiled, those who come out and not veiling, they should be targeted. Which is, again, it's a new development. We've seen the past couple of weeks, past few months, when the movement started, more and more women are coming out completely unveiled, which is very new. So the regime is now trying to target these citizens, those who are completely unveiled coming out. But even in targeting these citizens, it's trying not to do it directly through the morality police, but using different enforcement mechanisms, including forcing businesses not to provide service to women who are not veiled. So they are coming up with different ways. So going back to your main question, they are making some tactical adjustments You can see this as concessions, but they're not really concessions. The regime is very careful to make concessions without being seen as making concessions because they don't want to do what the Shah did, that basically giving an inch that would embolden the population. And yet they are trying to be flexible, come up with different ways to divide the protesters and reduce potential tensions in the short term until they can figure out that war of narratives that you mentioned earlier.
I just ask one more quick question to parliamentarian Haghighatjoo. The opposition may not need the clergy, but the regime does. And, you know, they keep going to Qom looking for it. The General Ghalibaf, the head of parliament, was there talking to Ayatollah Jawad Amili, Shirazi, Hamdani, and they're not getting it. What they're coming back is criticism. At the end of the day, their security forces, if they're loyal to the regime, they're loyal to the religious ideology of the regime. Can the regime afford not to have a clerical community that is very critical? And one of the parliamentarians, I think it was Abbasi or whoever, says, look, you got to stop criticizing us and offer a solution. How does you mentioned the resilience of the movement. How's the resilience of the security forces if clerical approbation outside the national government is not offered?
This is very important point, as you mentioned, clergy.
All my points are important.
Yes.
This is a particularly important point.
Absolutely. I mean, clergy has been a key element and key supportive of the regime, basically foundation of the regime. And Khamenei himself, other people around him have been tried directly, indirectly to engage them, to bring them to the core of the supporting the regime, but they did not lend the support to them. And this is very important, unfortunately, for several reasons. First of all, they don't listen to people. For instance, even Ayatollah Sistani, who is like a great marja'i taqlid for Shia community. So I've heard indirectly that he has been trying to provide some advice, but he say, unfortunately, nobody listens, or other people, other clergy. So they have been requesting reform, not only clergy, even within the system, within the security forces, call for the reform. But unfortunately, the supreme leader, as a key decision maker, doesn't basically accept those, doesn't accept a call for reform, which is this call for reform is ranges from simple reform to wider reform. And I think that is, clergy now is in very hard position. In one point, clergy has been targeted by the movement, and young, especially young people, see them as an ally of the regime itself. So they are targeted by the activists, yeah, protesters. On the other hand, they have been targeted by the security forces, by the leaders. So they originally have been placed in a very hard position. So maybe this is one reason also they are absolutely silent. They try to be not support the regime, not support the basically the protester, because of the different position they have. I think gradually the regime try to move from the clergy to the security forces. For instance, if we see the combination of the government, and when I say as government, as a general, the parliament, the like executive office, even the judiciary, we see more and more military people compromise those institutions. So they also, the regime rely less, but definitely regime needs a clergy, and this is a hard position for the regime and for the clergy themselves as well.
Thank you. I'll open up for questions. If you have questions, Rina can directly to have go ahead and post questions to our two speakers.
Thank you, Dr. Takeyh. As a reminder, to ask a question, please click the raise hand icon on your screen to indicate that you would like to ask one. When you are called on, please accept the unmute prompt and state your name and affiliation, followed by your question. You may also submit a written question via the Q&A feature in your Zoom window at any time. We will take our first question from Aza Karam from the Religions for Peace International.
Thank you very much indeed to the distinguished speakers, Dr. Tabaar, Dr. Haghighatjoo, and Dr. Takeyh. A very, very interesting and stimulating presentation. A request, if I may, for two specific clarifications. The first is I heard a very clear point made by Dr. Mohammad Tabaar that religion has no role to play in this space and is not what has been motivating. At the same time, I thought that the whole point was about the veil and the imperative behind it, and therefore that created that whole setup. And then I heard very compelling conversations about the role of the clergy. So what is it? Is there no relationship? Is there some relationship? If there is, what is it? And sometimes being against the religious current in and of itself is a critical aspect of the religious engagement or lack thereof. But the other question that I had is really more nuanced about, if you could please, Dr. Fatemeh, highlight the point about the potential for leadership, alternative leadership, not only within the country, because one of the questions I heard some of our Iranian colleagues and friends say is, well, you know, they're arguing for regime change. They want the downfall of the regime, but who would it be then? If this regime falls, well, who's going to take, you know, what would it be? So that is a question I'm curious about, your own read on. But the other is, are there, if we lack potential leaders from within or without, or ones who are obviously within and aligned with those diaspora, is that not a situation very similar to other contexts? I think of my own context in Egypt with the conflict, and therefore how easy it was for the military to step in because of this so-called gap in leadership. Would anything like that, what would that actually imply for what's going to happen now? Thank you.
Thanks. What does the day after look like? Ms. Haghighatjoo?
Yes, thank you so much. First on whaling, unfortunately, unlike many other Muslim majority countries, this regime tied hijab to its own existence, which is a very bad idea in general. And even though other people, even within religious community, clergy community, wanted to ease, you know, there is tension really on that. Some calls that as an important point. Some, they say, we should not enforce hijab. So there is tension on being needed to have hijab or not. But the final word is for Khamenei. So Khamenei clearly stated hijab is mandatory and has to be enforced. Yesterday, the judiciary issued a statement, even though the statement was absolutely illegal. They pointed out to several articles, legal articles, which is I went studied, and those are really fake, not relevant to hijab, but anyhow, this is not the first time they do illegal action, right? So because the leader said the hijab is mandatory and has to be enforced, judiciary jumped in, even though there is no law, there is only one law about 70 lashes up to 2 months imprisonment. but the judiciary has created something new, which is needed a parliamentary legislation. Without parliamentary legislation, they issued something which is, as I said, it all of their action has been illegal for past 100 days and so. So this is on a religious side, which is, it's not easy to really analyze that section. On the leadership, yes, that I think one reason that maybe not majority of people join to this current movement is fear of tomorrow. What tomorrow would look like? Who is going to take over? Still, the generation, this generation has a memory of Pahlavi's dynasty that they thought, yes, by the revolution, they are going to have freedom. And then from secular dictatorship, country become a theocracy. Another way, even the worst form of dictatorship. And but not now knowing that what is going to happen in future, I think this fear plus the fear of crackdown on the people prevent everybody to join. So I see, I believe Iranians are so talented. I believe Iranians have the leadership capacity inside the country and outside of the country. But still, everybody has its own narrative, own ideology. Some people want a return of dynasty. Some other want Republican. But there is a mess, basically. But I think we have experience of religious dictatorial system, an authoritarian regime, and this will be one great lesson that allow the next state become secular state. I think this is the minimum agreement everybody has felt, even those who are inside the country. There is now a great call for like not having supreme leadership part of the constitution or next regime. But I think there have been efforts to create those leadership and create a clear future for post-transition Iran, which I believe and I hopeful that that will be shaped. But it may take at least a year to reach to that point that we have a clear leadership and united leadership.
Professor Tabaar, do you want to take a crack at what comes next and what does the day after look like?
Sure, but let me quickly respond to the first question on the issue of religion, that how can this not be about religion? This is about religion. But what I was trying to say was that that for the protesters, religion is not being used to mobilize the masses as it was the practice for a long time in Iran, going back to the tobacco movement in the 19th century and later the constitutional movement, then the Iranian revolution in 79, all until recently. Every time there was a movement, you saw either the clerics play the leading role or religion in general was very much part of the language and discourse of the protesters. But this time around, what we see is that that this generation, this new generation of the protesters who came out in the past few months, this does not necessarily reflect the view of the silent majority that I said, but for those who came out based on their slogans, what we saw that they did not formulate their political actions and demands in religious terms. And again, this is a remarkable shift, at least according to many observers inside Iran. and you look at even the reform movement that Fatemeh was part of, you look at the Green Movement in 2009, religious discourse was very much part of it, trying to use this to mobilize the masses and also to undermine the cohesion of religion, for the very reason that Ray said a few minutes ago, that you need that in order to undermine the cohesion of security forces. So, and again, there was this belief that only a diamond can cut a diamond. You need to have this kind of a discourse. But for this generation of protesters, they seem to have just gone way beyond this. They don't even bother to engage with this, not to mention the anti-clericalism that we see rising. A lot of clerics have been attacked. And that is why many pro-regime clerics this time decided to remain silent, because they don't want to increase the resentment and the anti-clericalism that they see in the society. So that's what I meant. I didn't mean this is not about religion. It is about religion, but that it is no longer being used, at least for the time being, by the protesters the way it was in the past. And then in terms of what is after, so very quickly, this is the issue, that no one has been able to articulate a viable alternative so far, and that is why a lot of people, that is partly why a lot of people did not come out to join the protesters. There is a diaspora movement, as Fatemeh said, it was divided for a long time, but they seem to have shown some form of unity in the past few months and weeks. Some of them, some activists and journalists and athletes and artists, they have gotten together and forming a coalition. But the question is, if we don't know if they can translate this into a bigger, you know, political organization that is seen legitimate inside Iran, that is credible, that can create basically call for political action inside Iran. So we haven't seen this. If that happens, then yes. So far, it seems that this coalition has been more influential outside Iran, trying to change policies of European and Canadian and American governments than affecting inside Iran, because it just started. So we'll see. We have yet to see to what extent it will be successful. But again, the lack of an alternative, a viable alternative, is what keeps a lot of people at home.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Our next question is a written submission from Chloe Breyer from the Interfaith Center of New York, who asks if you could speak about the connection between or the influence on Afghanistan and Iran right now.
Professor Tabaar, you want to start with that?
I'm not an Afghanistan expert, but quickly, yes. So it is, I think, is one of the most important and understudied developments as far as it's connected to Iran. The rise of the Taliban, a group that went almost into war with Iran in 98, and coming back to power now, is going to be an important development in the long term. Based on the commentaries we saw when the Taliban came to power 2 years ago, coming out of Iran, it seemed Iran had a completely, at least the conservative establishment, had a very different view of the Taliban this time around. They did not see them as the enemy that the group was 20 years earlier. This time they saw the Taliban as a potential anti-American ally. So they kept emphasizing that Taliban was an anti-American group. They defeated the Americans, and therefore they could be a potential partner, which is very interesting, because ideologically and ethnically, the Taliban could not have been farther from Iran. At the time when Iran could have, and there was a call, especially from the more moderate elements within the regime, that Iran could try to back the Persian-speaking ethnic groups, or the Hazara, the Shia Hazaras. The regime decided not to, and because they didn't want to antagonize the Taliban, and more importantly, because it did see the Taliban as a potential partner. At some point, I even heard some regime strategists saying the Taliban could be a potential member of the Axis of Resistance. That's how they see the Taliban. But so far, it hasn't materialized, and there have been some tensions between Iran and the Taliban because of what is happening, border issues and the Taliban crackdown on their own population and other things. But it is an important development, and it can go both ways. Taliban could be a very serious threat to Iran in the long term. It's a potent force, but at the same time, as I said, Iran, the current regime, the current ruling faction is trying to cultivate a partnership based on anti-Americanism. So we'll see if that will materialize.
Thank you. I'll go to the next question.
Our next question comes from Charles Randall Paul from the Foundation for Religious Diplomacy.
Hello, wonderful conversation. I have two quick questions. One, has there in the last few years ever been a public opinion poll that could be considered legitimate for the citizens of Iran? And number two, has anyone worked on a coalition of, shall we say, traditional, very strongly religious believers in Iran and what we might call the liberal agnostic group who merely want religious freedom? If you if you sense an American tilt on that question, you'll see that the original Bill of Rights came about mainly because of a compromise between the adamant Baptists, who wanted to pitch their religion strongly in America and wanted to be allowed to do that, and the agnostics, who did not want religion to control the government. And so they came up with the great compromise of you can practice whatever you want, but you can't be involved in government. I'm wondering if there's any thought at all going on in Iran of saying yes to religion with great enthusiasm, but also yes to freedom to not be religious.
Let me piggyback on that, for Dr. Haghighatjoo. It is also said that regime enjoys 20% of support among the population. I have no idea where that figure comes from. How would you, and I realize it's dynamic, it changes. How would you assess the core supporters of the regime? I see opinion, Etimad does opinion polls all the time. I have no idea if they're reliable. But how do you assess what, if at all possible, what level of support the regime continues to enjoy? And from which segment of the population?
Thank you. So on public opinion, yes, there have been some reliable public opinion. Many have done inside Iran and also outside Iran. General understanding from that public opinion, which is showed a trend that Iranian become less and less religious. And we've seen footage of videos, we hear stories that confirm that polling, and some of these polls have been done by the regime itself. Regarding yes to religion and yes to freedom of religion, I think we see that very interestingly. Mr. Abdul Hamid, leader of Sunni in Sistan and Balochistan, have been played great role in past 100 days, which is very unique role. I haven't seen any other religious leader to play a role. He has been played, and every week they come out after Friday prayer. In his speech, many times he supported Iran is for all citizens, regardless of if they are religious or not. And even he mentioned name of Baha'is, that Baha'i has a right to practice and their right has to be preserved, which is in some religious community, Baha'is hasn't have the right. And even if we look at the Iranian constitution, Shia has absolute right. And to some extent, Abrahamic religion has some right, but some religions such as Baha'ism has no right at all. Even if they say if they confess they are Baha'i, they will be barred from going to school, as simple as that, like, or have a profession or so on and so forth. Very basic. They are denied their basic right. I think in general, in society, we see people are more tolerant toward a different type of religious spectrum. On core supporter of the regime, I think analyzing election in past 20 years shows almost what is the core element of the regime, which is if we analyze election result, which we have done before a couple of times, that number comes to 10 to 15%. But this 10 to 15%, some are traditional religious people. They feel support of the regime is part of their religious duty. Basically, they buy what they buy regime's narrative on use of religion. Some supporter of the regime who have been benefited financially. Also, I think that is another part. And as we see, one reason that security forces, especially Sepah, have been a great core for the regime is because of this financial and political gain that they have gained throughout these 40 plus years. Mm-hmm. This is the core from my point of view.
Professor Tabaar, do you agree that it's 10-15%? And is it situated in a socioeconomic class or is more diffused as Dr. Haghighatjoo suggested?
So there have been some public polls and some of the some government sponsored polls, and there were some reports that based on some government sponsored news agencies such as Fars that were classified, but they were kind of, I think they were hacked a few weeks ago. They came out and they showed that we see different figures, but something around 15% regime has the core supporters. And again, it kind of fluctuates. Sometimes it's less, sometimes it's more, based on how, you know, what kind of threats they feel, religious or political. But I don't think this has necessarily any specific, let's say, social base. I think it's widespread, fragmented, different parts of the society, different parts of the country. But I do think a significant portion of it is among the core, basically, those who get the financial support from the regime, the families of the Revolutionary Guards, the security apparatus, and those who have specific vested interests. So this is more about the, political and economic interests that they have connected directly to the regime. I don't think it's necessarily ideological, unless they fear that the day after could be an anti-regime government. At that point, yes, we do see, as Fatemeh said, some traditional religious segments of the people, they show some reluctant support for the regime because they fear an alternative. But relatedly, let me just say, because the second question is really, really important, and that is, if we see the alliance between more religious people and the liberal agnostic people, we do see the a rise in the in resentment among many religious people who are kind of apolitical, and they see that they go out to the streets and they see that a lot of people hate them because they see them as being part of the regime. They're not part of the regime, but they're being part of the regime. So there is a lot of anecdotal evidence that shows more and more religious people are actually advocating for a secular government precisely because they want to be left alone. They don't want to be seen as part of the regime when they're not. And also they are tired of the state control of their religiosity. You know, it's widely said that when the revolution happened, one of the famous figures, clerics at the beginning, right after the revolution, said the first casualty of this revolution is is Islam itself. And this is true because a lot of clerics, a lot of religious institutions, they lost their independence because suddenly you have an Islamic government that wants to control the official narrative. So, and in that sense, we see a rise. But, and, you know, recent one of the figures who came out during this movement a few months ago was Fatemeh Sepehri, a religious figure. And she was very critical of Ayatollah Khamenei, and she's now in prison. She's fully covered with chador. So there are a lot of religious people who are part of this movement precisely because they want to be left alone in their religiosity. So they're advocating for a secular government and for freedom. So
thank you. I'll take the next question as we're wrapping up. So next question, please.
Our next question is an anonymous submission. They ask, there is a critique in some quarters that the protests inside Iran have lacked the necessary intellectual and ideological rigor to persuade and invite the more learned layers of Iranian society to itself. There has been violence, vulgar language, lack of informed intellectual figures, reliance has been on celebrities, stars, sportsmen, etc. Outside Iran, the discourse has similarly been divisive and pretty violent, plagued with personal attacks, defamations, etc. What is the way out of this?
Thank you. Please, Dr. Haghighatjoo.
Yes, I think there was also another question that what we can do, what NGO outside of Iran can do to support. I think to answer this question together is like advocating for non-violent action strategy and tactic. Exactly, once people advocate for violence, that basically super problematic, first of all, that creates fear of future. Like some of these who have been engaged even in crackdowning on the people, they may continue crackdown because they think what will happen to them after the regime. So they would try to fight to the last portion. This is one point. The second point also, encouraging violence, as Erica Chenoweth research shows, that 55% of non-violent, first of all, 55% of movement in general got succeeded to change a regime, and non-violent movement succeeded twice than violent. So encouraging peaceful transition to democracy is very important. And I think opposition outside of the country has to advocate for peaceful transition. Absolutely, I disagree with those who advocate for eye for eye, understanding and usage of violence. At the end of the day, the Iranian government has upper hand on use of violence, and basically they try to find way and excuses to crack down more on people, and that really is in favor of the regime itself, and it's not provide any support for the protesters.
As we wrap up, let me ask Professor Tabaar and also Dr. Haghighatjoo, tell me how this ends.
I could not understand your question.
Start with Professor Tabaar. Tell me how this ends.
Let me just start by saying that the last point that was raised is very critical and very unfortunate, and that is how this movement gradually became vulgar and has no intellectual. I would even go further and say it, part of it is very anti-intellectual, and many of some of the leaders outside or some of those activists inside, they even brag that this is an anti-academic, anti-intellectual movement or approach that they have adopted, and the kind of language, as I said, as
by the way, there was plenty of vulgarity in the 79 revolution.
But not maybe it's because of the social media. I don't know. But this level,
I saw a lot of things about Farah Pahlavi and others and during the 79
but
revolution.
I don't know,
go ahead.
If people attack each other the way they are doing now, I mean, as soon as somebody's coming out saying something that the other side sees a little bit too moderate, or people are being accused of being different things. So this is pretty vicious. And I actually think that this has partly affected those silent majority again, not to come out. And again, even in the media, people are just broadcasting these things, which is surprising. So where is the way out? So
how does this end?
What
happens?
From whose perspective? I'm not super optimistic. As this is becoming more and violent, I think the regime has an upper hand in the short term. But in the long term,
in your perspective, it ends with regime restoring its authority in some respects.
In the short term, but no, in the long term, no. There is no way easy out for the regime this time around. So how is this going to end? Let me just very quickly say, my fear is there could be a diversionary war in the region that is caused by either the regime or neighboring countries miscalculating, like 1980 Saddam Hussein, and that could help the regime to restore order. That is my fear.
Dr. Haghighatjoo, very quickly, how does this end?
Well, I think the current situation will continue unless the opposition be able to form a core leadership to converted to post-transition. I don't see any chance for reform from within the system because Khamenei blocked it. So I think this like cat and mouse fight will continue for a while. This is a long term to go. I think at least will take 2 years to go.
Just a brief follow-up. Ms. Haghighatjoo, do you see a role for your former reformist colleagues, Abdul Nuri, Tajzadeh? Do you see a role for them in this movement and in the future of Iran?
I don't know for future of Iran, as you know that right now the regime itself and the opposition try to attack to the middle, which is the reformists. And that placed them in a hard situation. For instance, as you see, Abdullah Nuri, a couple of weeks ago, have issued a letter criticizing the leader, and he was called to the security forces for interrogation, even though he has defended. I doubt Khamenei basically compromise. If the Khamenei would compromise, I would have seen a role for the reformists, not. But I think as many activists, politicians, journalists, including former Speaker of the Parliament, Mehdi Karoubi, stated, maybe the best opening for change occurs in the days and months after Khamenei dies.
Thank you. I'll turn it over to Rina to wrap us up.
Thank you all very much for doing this. We really appreciate it. It was an excellent conversation, and I'm sorry we couldn't get to all of your questions. We will just have to reconvene. Just a reminder, you can follow Ray Takeyh at Ray Takeyh and also on the CFR.org website. We also encourage you to follow CFR's Religion and Foreign Policy Program on Twitter at CFR_religion. And do email us at outreach@CFR.org with any suggestions or questions for future webinars. And just a quick announcement, we will have our next webinar, our social justice webinar on U.S. immigration and repatriation on Thursday, July 26th at 12 p.m. Eastern Time. So keep a lookout for that invitation. Thank you all again for being with us, and thank you to our distinguished speakers.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you, everyone, for inviting me.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.